Good morning. Coming to you live from Pelham Road. I just wanted to say how thankful I am that my church offers us so many different ways to worship during these times, whether it's online or during our lunchtime meetings out in the courtyard or otherwise. And I just wanted to say thank you for being with us and welcome to worship.
So today, I have an old story to tell you. I hope I don't lose you in these couple of old stories at the beginning here. The Babylonian captivity is first a historical event. The Hebrews were defeated and taken into captivity by Babylon. The Babylonian captivity is discussed in the book of Jeremiah, 2 Kings, Ezra, Nehemiah. It's likely that these were written after the captivity. Daniel and Ezekiel were probably written while in captivity. And while the exact date for the ending of the captivity is still debated, the date 539 BC will not upset anybody. And we believe the captivity lasted 70 years. Now, the phrase Babylonian captivity came to have a meaning beyond the actual captivity. Whenever someone is displaced from their home or the place of, say, their strength, someone might say, well, they're in their Babylonian captivity. It signifies that they've been removed from their place of origin or their place of power. Now, I'll give you one example. I'll give you one example of this. In 1309, Pope Boniface and King Philip had serious disputes concerning the power of the Pope over secular matters that involved the church or her agents. Of course, taxation was a big part of this conflict and dispute. Kings and princes from elsewhere in Europe resisted the papal claims that were rooted in earlier centuries and began to assert a higher degree of independence. Often, of course, at the expense of the papal's political authority. So in 1302, Boniface VIII circulated a decree. And the decree subjected temporal power to spiritual authorities and ended with a summary, We declare, state, define, and pronounce that it is altogether necessary for every human creature to be subject to the Roman pontiff, emperor of the world. Philip, the king, responded by convening his own assembly, condemning the pope on numerous false charges, including heresy and depravity. His envoys imprisoned the pope at Anaga, although freed shortly after, Boniface VIII died. His successor, Benedict XI, did not live long, and so the next pope, Clement V, moved the papal court from Rome to Avignon, France, in 1309, where the church and the state's relationship was more cordial. So they left Rome and they moved to France. And this conflict lasted roughly from 1309 to 1377, before they actually moved back to Rome. So from 1309 to 1377 is roughly 70 years. And so this became known as the Babylonian Captivity of the Church. The Catholic Church had moved from its home or its source of power to a new place. Now, I actually cite other times where this phrase has been used and where this label has been appropriate. But I imagine you've already had enough just with those two, so I'll move on and won't cite anymore. As I reviewed the various times someone has been bold enough to make this accusation, the Babylonian captivity of the church, I noticed something. With the exception of the actual historical Babylonian captivity, these moments are when the world is changing swiftly and dramatically, and the church is trying to figure out how to remain relevant in these difficult days. That's usually when the phrase is used. 35 years ago, things swung into high gear concerning changes in worship music. The people who wanted change, they wanted drums and guitars and more praise music and choruses, accused those who opposed them on these matters as holding the church hostage to the past. Hostages to the good old days, they would say. They argued that denominational leaders were marching the church into the, yes, you remember, the Babylonian captivity. Now, the people on the other side, who thought Gaither music was almost too much, who enjoyed hymns and only felt the Spirit when they sung the third verse of a hymn, accused those who opposed them as holding the church hostage to the values of the culture, hostage to what's happening now. They argued that the radical worshipers were marching the church into the Babylonian captivity, where the culture would hold the keys to the future. So you see, it goes both ways. The Babylonian captivity phrase can be used to protect the status quo or break all the previous molds. Now, I don't mean to undermine my own argument here, but I want you to have the whole truth. The phrase has been used and misused to defend and attack practically anything. Now, the reason there was a Babylonian captivity in the first place was that Israel was defeated. The argument can be made that they lost because they were not as courageous or as numerous as the Babylonians. But a better argument is that they lost because they were lost. They lost their way. Some say God sent them into captivity. It's much more likely that they sent themselves into captivity, forgetting their relationship with God and forgetting the values that made them the people of God. The prelude to captivity is always forgetting who we are. That has never changed. If we forget who we are, in short order, we'll be captive. Now, captivity has been fought off many times in the life of the Christian church because we do have the courage to remember. We do. To remember and not bow down and worship idols. You see, one idol is called the past. It should be respected, but it cannot be worshipped. It cannot take the place of God. The past cannot take the place of God. Another idol is the latest and the greatest. Relevance is important, but relevance is not God either. I could continue and make a list of the usual suspects who the church and we the people of faith are tempted to bow down to. You would find agreement, no doubt, with some. But you would say, hey, now wait a minute, preacher, on some of them. But instead of getting distracted with this long list of idols, let's just cut to the chase and get to what we really need to do. We need to remember. And the first thing to remember is that we belong to God. We are stewards of the family of God that has been passed down from generation to generation for 2,000 years. Now, this past year has given church leaders a little breathing room to evaluate our ministry. And if we start back, just as we ended in March of 2020, I'm afraid we did not learn any lesson. Captivity, we see, can go either way. If we hold on to yesterday, then we are captive to nostalgia and tradition. And that's no way to do the Lord's work. And if we embrace the newest fad that the culture offers, well, that's no way to do the Lord's work either. Being captive, we need to remind ourselves, is feeling powerless to change things. It is to be stuck either in, I only want it if it's new, or why can't we do it the way we used to do it? To be stuck in either of those places is to be captive. To be captive is to say, well, we have to bring things back just the way they were, or people will get upset. Or it is to say, if we don't add some of these new improvements and innovations, the church is going to die. To be free, not captive, but to be free is to be able to line all of these things up, all of the options up, and then pick. That's what freedom is. Now, I know you're watching at home, but Sunday mornings here, well, they're beginning to look the same as they did some time ago. They don't actually sound the same yet, but they do look and feel remarkably like they did before we shut down. And further, there's really little worry that things will not sound the same in some time. But plenty of other things are not the same. Vacation Bible School had a new one-day approach. The welcome table on Wednesday is a different approach. But keep in mind, the biggest change is now we're re-examining everything. Worship, missions, education, all the things we do in the name of our Lord. In the past, we were sort of on autopilot. But today we're acting like we're free, not captive. Now I imagine everybody would like to go back to where the programming and the activities were all at our pre-pandemic level. But we're not going to be captive in either direction. Often, our activities and programs needed volunteers who would commit to 26 Sundays of leadership a year or serving 12 meals a year. And I believed a year ago that once our people had a year of very little obligation, like they did last year, they would want even less responsibility going forward. Thus, we're having to use our volunteers more judiciously. We are reimagining what is needed. We've always encouraged Christians to be weekday Christians, not just Sunday churchgoers. A trend that has become routine for many. They are committed, and they support God's work faithfully with their finances, and they are investing their time and their energy in doing missions and offering compassion and promoting justice. People's commitment to their faith is just as strong as ever. However, they are reevaluating how they invest their time. And that's okay. So some things that we've done in the past will not return to congregational life. Ever. They're gone. However, the best news here is that the programming that we have that follows Jesus' exact words, "I was hungry and you fed me," those ministries are enthusiastically supported to the brim and above. Thanks to our great servants at Triune, the Triune work will continue without interruption and has actually grown. And we also need to remember something else, since we're remembering. Koinonia is a Greek word for fellowship. The past year has revealed how valuable fellowship is to our congregation. I'm not convinced that fellowship means as much to other churches as it does to us. From the formal to the informal ways that we mingle, fellowship seems to be a dominant trait of Pelham Road. For some churches, I believe it's the music. Others, it's actually the building. For others, it's their doctrinal positions, which provide the glue for their church. But for us, it really does appear that it's nurturing fellowship. Future koinonia, or fellowship, will not require a committee or a team to prepare food and decorate tables. Future fellowship may just be simply an announcement. Next Sunday at 5 o'clock, we're going to be playing softball. Fans and players are welcome to bring your own lawn chair and food enough for your families. That's it. No fuss, no organization, just spontaneous. Or it could be something like, just join us this week on Wednesday night for ice cream at such and such place. Less organization, but more spontaneity, but just as much fellowship. Now, not everyone returned from the Hebrews captivity. You're not here on Sunday, but not all of our friends have returned. And all of us are saddened by this. But to the staff, this really isn't any surprise. Other churches that tell the truth report the same. And this is not news, it's not good or bad. It's just the way it is. People develop new habits. Others found other places to worship. We pray God's blessing on them. But this gives us the privilege to rebuild, to invite new souls to welcome people who may join us online or others who will join us in person, to open our arms and share God's love anew. Now, the Gospel of Mark that we read earlier stacks a few stories together with a common thread. The thread? Things wear out. Things change. God invents the new. Embrace the new wine. He begins this way. In the past, people of faith didn't share the table with sinful, broken souls. That's just not the way it was done. And along comes Jesus. In what way does he do it? A different way. Mark is announcing just because we once did it does not mean we need to continue to do it. Do it the Jesus way. Follow Jesus. Welcome all. The old way has become sort of baggage, if you listen to Mark. Religion that is for the righteous, by the righteous. And this baggage must be replaced. The new way is the life-giving Jesus way. The old can't contain the new. The common thread is the way it was is no more. The old wineskins are done. The old way of avoiding the sinner, finished. The old has worn out. The new is new, and it's risky, and it's different. Now, don't be confused. Jesus is not saying it's a choice between the new and the old. The old is finished. The choice is between the new with a positive attitude or the new with a bad attitude. The children of Israel went into captivity. They left their home. They left their way of life. Yet they went into captivity and they discovered something about themselves. They discovered new ways to follow God. Now, COVID-19 has sent us ever so briefly into a new place. And we were displaced for a moment. After the captivity, the Hebrews returned home. It wasn't the same, but it was everything they needed. To see familiar faces, to be among friends, to practice the best traditions, and to accept the new realities made them strong. We are on a quest to discover ways to embrace the changing times with God's message of grace and mercy. We are not the same as we were in 2020. Normal has died, but in its place, God is making us stronger. God is refreshing the church.
Counselor, Comforter. God bless those who wander, those who are tired, those who are afraid, the confused, the bewildered, the perplexed, the lonely, the forgotten, those who are beginning again, those who live with regret, those who struggle to forgive, the anxious, the unsure, the limping, the exhausted. In the name of the one who reassures, renews, comforts, and gives rest, we pray. Amen.